doing it behind, in the background, and this is an amazing, impossible job to do it, to organize all the lectures like this, with flexible ideas like putting someone at 8 o'clock, which is very good. It's a good solution. And thank you very much. I think you're doing much more than I could say. And now the 8 o'clock, it's a very good opportunity because I have you here at 8 o'clock, it means you really want to listen to me, which is make it very positive for me. Okay, let's go into positive victimology. And actually, Moshe set the stage so nicely because he asked you what you think. And what you said was just, you asked for positive victimology. And I'm glad that you did it, because at first when I had this idea about positive victimology, I heard several other ideas. At first, I was told there's nothing new in positive victimology. And I'm talking about positive in terms like positive psychology, etc., which I will go further soon. Not the positivistic school of criminology, or there was a book, Positive Criminology, by Hirsch and Goffertson. Not this. This is different. I'm coming from phenomenology, like Moshe, and this is much different than positivistic thinking. But I'm talking about positive, so people say there's nothing new. Victimology should be positive by itself. Well, yes. Well, not. It's not. And then someone said this is redundancy because, as I said, victimology should be positive. Then I was told that victimology cannot be positive. Like criminology, several years ago I offered positive criminology and I was told criminology by itself, by the very term, is negative. How can you say positive criminology? So victimology is also, by its very term, victims. It's negative. Victimization is always negative. So how can you say positive victimology? And myself, I also thought about it, that positive victimology can be impossible. I asked my friend Sarah, I asked my friend Moshe, I spoke with other people. We presented it first in The Hague, in the conference. We said it, we asked the audience whether victimology can be positive, etc. And the more I write and think and lecture about it, the more I'm convinced that there is a room for positive victimology. Actually, it's needed. And I hope that I will succeed to convince you as well. When I'm talking about positive victimology, I'm not talking, I will describe some approaches that I perceive to be representing positive victimology. But I'm not talking about what. I'm talking about how. How to. And there's a big difference between what and how. We are so much obsessed with what. What works, what does not work, etc. We forget that if you calculate what works, and if you do it correctly, you'll get to the idea that it doesn't matter what you do. It makes much more sense how you do it. And the positive victimology mostly is focused on how you do it. What's your approach to do it? What's your perspective? And I perceived positive victimology not to be a theory or a model or a practice, but a perspective on theory, model, or practice. And that's what I'm going to describe to you, the perspective of positive victimology. In a way, it reminds me, I think Gandhi said that if you want to bring a change, be the change you want to bring. Wow. It's a lot. Be the change you want to bring. It's very difficult. We are not perfect human beings. We would like to bring a perfect change. Well, do it modestly. is humble, but be the change you want to be. It means that you don't want to bring a bigger change when yourself, you are not in this situation. So, this is one of the ideas of positive victimology. When I'm using PowerPoint, rarely I do it, because when using PowerPoint, it means that my presentation is previously set. And I would like to feel you and to go with you, but I will do it, and maybe there's something will be written here, but I will not pay attention to it and say something different. Anyhow, about 20 years ago, I'm a clinical criminologist, I'm a therapist. It means that I work with people who are either considered to be offenders, drug addicts, substance addicts, sex addicts, etc., or people who were victimized by any other abuse of power. And about 20 years ago, I worked in the domestic violence field, and I worked with male betterers at first, and then I worked with better women. And I remember that when women came to the center that I worked for, and this clinic was belonged to a woman organization, and the main idea that was there, that if you suffered from your husband and you were better, the bad thing for you is to leave your husband. It means divorce was very much pushed by the center and the woman who worked there. Well, it may be right. It may be the best solution from the standpoint of the professionals who worked in that clinic. But was it the best solution for the woman who came for help? If you ask most of the women, and it was repeated time and again, and you ask them, what do you want? I want to live peacefully with my beloved husband as it was before, as you dreamt about. That's what I want. Please fix him, so he'll not better me anymore. I don't want to leave him. Women were pushed to complain in the police, which is very clever, because the man will never go to therapy because he's in spin, unless there is a force greater than him, and the police can be. But it's a one-way road, because once she complained in the police, she can't take it away. And then, 2-3 years after, when the police remind itself that it has to treat this case, and this man might go to prison, or might whatever happened to him. And I'm not sure this is what the woman has wanted. And I remember a case, a woman, she was really severely battered, cruelty, battered by her husband. It was a chronic battering, lasted for several times. She complained in the police several times. It didn't help. He was criminal as well, this man. He was an offender. Very violent person, outside home, inside home, anywhere. And when the police finally came and took him to jail, she said, please, do not arrest him. He is not a bad man. He is a sick, suffering person. Treat him. That's what I want. I want him back at home, but without violence. That's what she wanted. Actually, it was lucky, because it was a very interesting story, because he was in jail, and half the night he said to his partners in the cell, I'm going to kill this woman. I'm going to kill her like this and like this. She put me in jail? In our neighborhood, you don't put anyone in jail. And your husband? He should be kept in the family. We can write him. I'm going to kill her. I'm going to beat her. Daddy, I'm going to kill her. That's it. And then in the middle of the night came another man, who was also a better man. He said, look, sorry for this, how shit we are. We better than We gave them hell. And now what you are complaining about, she putting you in jail? What opportunity she has? And this was by another man in jail, so he believed this person. Next thing he did in the morning, he was free, released from jail in the morning, and he looked for therapy. But this is rarely happens. Anyway, it was 20 years ago. Unfortunately, I've read papers, very recent papers. Actually, there is a chapter in the book that's going to be published soon named Positive Criminology. Then I'm the editor. And there's a chapter about domestic violence, and the literature there is up to date. And it says still the same. In the domestic violence field, women are pushed for divorce much more than they want. And there are several studies who say this. So this is victim assistance. Is it positive? I'm not so much sure. So there's a room for positive victimology. Victimization is always a negative experience. So, ideally, we would like to solve the suffering of the victim by letting these people having a very positive experience. So that's why positive victimology is so natural. Ideally, the reaction to victimization should always be positive. Unfortunately, this is not the case. So, if I look at the roots of positive victimology, which is a newly defined perspective, it's rooted in positive psychology. Positive psychology was a kind of transformation in thinking, because it said something which is very, today we say it very easily, very natural, but it said that we should not look only on negative effects, circumstances, etc. And we are obsessed with the negative, especially in criminology, victimology especially. We look for things that, for suffering points, we look for negative background, etc., etc. We are obsessed with the negative, we are afraid of the negative, we try to avoid the negative. And you may ask me, what is negative and what is positive? It is relative, yes, but we all know what do we feel as negative when we are out. So there's, of course, this is relative, this is subjective, negative and positive, but still, if you look at the criminological literature, victimological literature, you see, or the psychological literature, you see that we are much more obsessed with the negative than we write about the positive. And I think that the idea that came into our mind by positive psychology is very, very important. That we turn our minds into the positive. There are some opportunities in the positive. We should not only learn the negative. Yes, the negative has an impact. Of course it has an impact. But it's not the only impact. And if we study and put so much emphasis on the negative, then we can or might forget the impact of the positive. And who has a stronger impact, the negative or the positive? Now remember, be the change you want to bring. What change you want to bring, a negative or a positive? Avoidance of the negative only, or you want to bring a positive change? So it means, be the change you want to bring, be positive as much as you can. This is what positive psychology would say. So we learned something for positive psychology. Positive criminology, well, naturally it follows positive psychology. We defined it several years ago. We did some studies out of phenomenology, of course. I don't do other studies. And we saw that there are very good reasons to have positive criminology in mind. And positive criminology takes the ideas of positive psychology and put it into the criminological context. And it has some more contribution, which I'll define later. And This is a girl who mentioned it a few days ago, and they attribute it to our friend and colleague Sarah Ben David, Victims, Victimology, Sarah in 2000, paper about we have to build victimology on the basis of what victims want, what victims feel, experience, etc. Victims, victimology. So positive victimology should, of course, include victims' victimology inside it. It can't be only professionals' victimology without the victims there. Otherwise, it's, as far as I see it, it's not positive. Well, I think Moshe described it pretty well, that there is a victimization process. There is a development of a victim's identity, and Gerd also pretty nicely described it in the that victimization is a process that invasion of the self. It comes into yourself. You become, your identity becomes as a victim, and Shlomo that Moshe described presented pretty well. So we need to have the opposite process to have to help people to come out of this identity as victims. We have to change their narratives, Christine, as you said before, to help people to change their own narratives of from victims to something else, okay, which is more positive. Now, I speak about positive and negative, and I should explain what do I mean by positive and negative. I think that, in a way, I'm an idealistic. I'm looking for the spirit of everything. The spirit of psychology, when I studied psychology, the spirit of criminology, and the spirit of victimology. Victimology has a spirit, everything has a spirit. See, spirituality. And victimology has a spirit. And the spirit of victimology, I think this is the distinguish between what is negative and what is positive. We aspire for something. We wish something. Being in the negative is being stuck, maybe spinned in the ease. As the those we call victims are in a victimization spin somehow, we professionals are also spinned in the victimization spin. We are stuck in it. We are only on the ease. What's there? And positive victimology aspires for something else. What we wish to, what can be, what might be, what should be, in the spirit of something. It means we can fly high, in a way. Not only what we refrain from, what we try to avoid, what we run away from, but where do we go? Remember, be the change you want to be. Where do you want to go? Be the change you want to be, it means go where you want to go. Emphasis is put much more on the positive than the negative. And positive psychology teaches us that if you put emphasis on the positive, it has power to change. It means many times you don't have to run away from the negative. All you should do is try as much as you can to adopt the positive. The negative will subside by itself if you follow the positive. This is one way, Moshe, to end the victimological spin, is to attempt to help a person to transform the focus from the negative to the positive. It may be one day at a time, slightly, gradually, but it can be. So what is the negative that we refrain from, and what is the positive we aspire for? Of course, harm. And well, harm is very subjective. What one person calls harm, maybe other people will not call harm, but still, if I do like this, sorry for this dick, it may hurt dick. If he does it to me, it may harm to me. We know what harm is. There's some common sense of harm we all know. There's a subjective personal component in harm. We can understand it, but also there's some common experience. As human beings, it may be the what can be different from one person to another, but we know that there is something we call harm. We know that, that there's something that we call negative, we don't want it. That there is something that may cause pain, emotional, social, economical, physical pain, and we don't want it. What causes pain may be different from person to person, but still there's something we call pain and you don't want it. Harm to self, harm to others, and harm by others. Different kinds of harms. Of course, we would like justice, we would like support, and we would like love. Well, I'm talking about love, romantic person, isn't it? Yes, love. We forget to say that people want to be loved. They want to be cared, but they want to be loved. They want to experience love. And this is speaking about positive. People do not only want not to be harmed. Yes, we all want not to be harmed, but we want to love, we want justice, we want support, and we want love, we want caring, etc. Victimization is a process of exclusion, of separation. The very moment of even one time victimization is separation, is a process of separation. And the process of becoming a victim, that I said before, is a process of separation in several levels that I will describe shortly. But there is a process of separation, not only social. Social, interpersonal, intrapersonal, and spiritual separation. Three levels of separation at least. Exclusion. So, the positive is, if there is the negative pole, there is a positive pole. And there is a movement from the negative to the positive. That's what I'm trying to describe. It's a vector. It means it has a direction. Integration, unification, this is the positive direction. And if we take, for example, the idea of the place where I worked for domestic violence, they put a lot of emphasis on separation and not on integration. And integration should be much better as far as dependency and powerlessness. And I think Shlomo case, what Moshe described, is a case of powerlessness, a sense of powerlessness, and a sense of dependency. I cannot, I cannot, I cannot, I cannot, so please do it for me. And I think, Sarah, that's what you meant by the career of the victim, that powerlessness and dependency. And dependency. A lot of dependency. And the more you are stuck in the process, the more the spin is there, the more dependent you are. And it can be for individuals, it can be for groups, sometimes for very large groups. So, if this is the negative pole, the positive pole will be independence, a sense of strength, ability. If this is inability, this is ability, capability. I can do it. Not I cannot, but I can do it. And of course, self-centeredness. My own belief is that in having any kind of either behavioral problem, personality problem, or whatever disorder, behavioral disorder, or victimization, there is a component, a core component of self-centeredness. The person is self-centered by the threat, by the whatever. And in the victimization process, there is a growing process of becoming more and more self-centered. Again, Shlomo's case can represent it pretty well. I see it many times in my own clinic where people come to me or they suffer a kind of victimization. And this victimization, which when it becomes the core experience in life, it makes a person stuck in oneself, self-centered. So we would love to see people going from this negative pole of self-centeredness to the positive, towards the positive of other-centeredness or God-centeredness as a person understands God. This distinguish between the two poles, the negative and the positive, and this list is of course not inclusive. You can put more vectors here and there that this I describe as the negative and this I describe as the positive. And it's up to more research to do it, or clinical experience or theoretical thinking about to describe more poles, two sides. I think that this scheme provides us a pragmatic understanding of what may assist in evaluating the strengths and relevance of different interventions, because we can look at different interventions or different approaches in victimology and see what to describe as negative and positive, what do they emphasize, and how do they deal with the different poles, etc. And then it can help us to know what we are doing, what prepositions do they hold, etc., etc. Okay. By the way, you can stop me with questions, comments, etc. at any moment. I would love to have it. Anyhow. As far as I see it, as I said, positive victimology is perspective. And as a perspective, there are many theories and models that share this perspective already. Positive victimology is a new term for old approaches, existing approaches in victimology, in criminology, in psychology, in whatever. So there are these approaches, models, theories, and there's an umbrella concept that says positive victimology. We call them positive victimology. And they share something together. What do they share? They share the idea that any reaction, and I think you said it before, any reaction to victimization should be experienced as positive by those involved, at least those that we call them victims. It means that the person who is called the victim, who suffered from victimization, should experience the intervention as much as possible as positive. Otherwise, we may even be in the danger of doing re-victimization. And I think that today we had an example when there was the DVD that Paul Darby showed us, and we thought that the community reacted to this lady in a way that was a secondary victimization. And the woman who is going to a women's shelter and she is pushed there for divorce or whatever, she is going into a re-victimization process if it's against her wish. And many times we see that people are pushed in a direction for that might be re-victimization. I want to tell you a story. Several years ago, there was a young lady who was referred to me. It came out that she worked in actually in Bar-Ilan University as administrative, actually in the very same building that I work in. So I knew the persons involved somehow. She was badly sexually abused during her childhood by different people. Sometimes it was one time, sometimes it was repeated. Some were strangers, some were people she knew, even a relative. And she came to me many years after, she was in her mid-20s, and she was stuck in a victimization spin. And then after, she did pretty well. Some progress was there, very slowly, of course. We had a good connection in between us. She felt very good in my office. And some people here saw the office. You cannot feel not good in this office. The atmosphere is very good, very positive, etc., etc. Am I true, Dick?
True indeed.
True indeed, yes. This is a tent over the roof of my house in Jaffa. It looks pretty well. Yurta, if you know what is this, it's a Mongolian tent. Very lovely. Not so warm in summer because we have air condition, not so cold in winter because the air condition also warmed the place. Amazing, a tent with an air condition, looks pretty well, and she felt very good there and with me. And then she told me that there is a man. This man, he works with the office that she works for in the university, and he does not belong to the university, he is connected somehow, and he is very important. She is not, he is very important. And he is an old man, relatively, well, she said so. Maybe it is in my age, but I'm also considered old by her. Anyhow, he is an old man, and he loves her very much. Whenever he sees her, he hugs her so strongly, with so much love, to feel her body. She doesn't like him. She tries to avoid him. The more she tries to avoid him, it became a joke in her office. Her manager is joking about her. And then there was, the other day, he came, she heard his voice, so she went to another office. She ran away. And then he went away, so it means it was over. She could come safe to her office. The moment she came in, he came back. Here you are, my love. Oops, like this and kisses, etc. Enjoying her young, soft body. She felt like, but she can't say anything. We heard about violence in the workplace, and he has the power. Amazing, that's it. She could not resist it. She had a method of to deal with such things, to disconnect herself from the situation. Dissociation, we call it. So she dissociated pretty well. It means that she is not there, her body only is there, but she feels bad for it. He went away. It was another time a joke in the office. A joke that she wasn't part of. It was against her wishes, of course. And then she told me in the office about it. And I said, we have to do something. She said, I don't want to do anything. Now, I'm in the middle of it. Shall I let it go? She doesn't want it. I want her experience to be as positive as I can. What to do? It happened that I knew the lady, luckily it was our university, so I knew the lady was in charge of women of sexual complaints in the institute. She was a friend of mine. And I told this young woman, I know the lady who is in charge of. Do you want me to speak with her? No, not at all, not at all. Do you want me to speak with her anonymously? I will not mention your name, I'll just ask her, in general, what to do. She agreed. So I called this woman the other day. I said, well, this and that happened. This young lady doesn't want you to know her name, doesn't want you to know any details. What do you propose? And she said, if you can convince her to come to my office, I will do nothing. I just want to hear it from her mouth. That's it. I promise her, I keep anonymity as much as so you see, we have to be very careful that this young woman will keep the positive experience as much as possible, and with our good intention, we will not re-victimize her, because it's so easy to do something and to be actually to violate her own intentions, wishes, or self-dignity. We went to that office. She had a very warm and good experience with this woman. And finally, we had a very good solution. This woman will call this man and she will tell him, "We know that you are doing something sexual to women in this organization. It's not allowed here. Please stop it." That's it. Without, of course, mentioning the name of this young woman. She did so. The other day, the man came. He looked at her and he said nothing. He didn't try to hug her, didn't say, "My love, where are you?" And that's it. And it was a victory for her. She felt so strong for it. This is a positive experience. And I must say, there were many junctions on this road that we could easily miss, but all the time in my mind was it should be positively experienced by her all the time. Should be positively experienced by her. We have to look at it like this. It should be always positively experienced. So although this is very clear when we sit here and think about it, it's very clear, but sometimes out of our very good intentions, we do it wrongly. Because we want the solution. We want where we go to, but we forget how we go to. And as far as I think, how we go to leads us to where we go to. And keep in mind, we want to be the change that we want to bring. Not the target, not the destination. We want to be the process that we want to bring. And the process should be very positive as much as it can be. Another thing is that this process has direction. Not only positive experience. Positive experience is very good, and by itself it has a lot of healing power. And this is the second component, healing. In my mind should be healing. Our mind as victimologists should be healing. We are working for recovery. Recovery can be social, recovery can be financial, recovery of course should be emotional. Recovery is a multi-layers process, but in our mind should be recovery as much as possible, because victimization is a process that goes into the self. Destructive process. The victimization event is the beginning of a destructive process. It is there as an experience, as a memory, but then the process, the person continues by him or herself. It means that we have, in a way, to reverse this process, to get into healing. And this healing, this is the third component, will be, I would say always, it will contain a process of integration. Since a common experience of any victimization, or almost any victimization, is a sense of separation, and integration is a very important part of this process. And this integration, as I said before, is a three-leveled. Social or intrapersonal integration of the victim as self, and a spiritual unification. I want to go further into it. Social integration is, of course, most of the times is the first to be experienced. And it's a need, but not only a need, it's more than a need. It's an experience, it's a positive experience, it's a wish. A person who was traumatized, who was separated forcibly by the very victimization event, wishes to be included, reintegrated So there is a need to think about social inclusion. So if we plan a solution, if we plan a process, if we plan a method, if we plan an intervention, if we plan an approach, we should keep in mind this approach should be socially inclusive as much as we can. As much as we can, because we cannot do anything. As much as we can, socially inclusive. It means that we have to keep, for example, when Mali presented, she described the violence in the families who are from the ultra-Orthodox Jewish families. And we saw that there, if the woman goes out, washing the dirty laundry of the family outside, this is actually social exclusion. So if we keep up this in mind, we think that any solution should include social inclusion, social integration. So I cannot emphasize it too much. I mean, I put a lot of emphasis on it and will put more and more, because social inclusion is a basic component and very important one. And many times we tend to forget it. We tend to forget that the person is part of community, that the person is part of a group. And social inclusion means to look at what group this person belongs to, what family this person belongs to. Sometimes it is impossible, because if the surrounding, the social surrounding is destructive, there will be no inclusion, no integration. But then we'll have to think about a new integration, a new social integration. We have to keep in mind that any solution must contain social integration. But this is not enough, because the process of becoming a victim is a process of intrapersonal sense of separation or dissociation. And there is a known process of dissociation. The person is dissociated from oneself. I can tell you an example. A woman who tells me about having sex with her husband, and she said, well, it's not me there. I'm over there on the ceiling, flying somewhere, and there's my body who does it. This is dissociation. And she can't associate with herself in certain moments in life. And it is an experience of many people, of a kind of inner separation. It means that recovery should go into self-integration, to help the person to self-integrate in order to have a kind of recovery. And this is a process. We don't reach a perfection, we can progress into this process. And there's spiritual unification, and this is my own system of belief, that we are not only on this material world, there's something more than it in this world. And if we want to go out of self-centeredness, we have to aspire for something that is greater than ourselves. I speak with my clients about their own faith and beliefs. I do believe in myself, in God, so I can freely discuss it without being belong to any religion, of course, freely, according to the positive experience of that person, always positive experience of that person, but to have some spiritual vision, because we are not only what we see here, there's something more in being human, and to look at what is beyond our existence here and now. And most people have some idea, any kind of idea about what is our location in life, what is meaning of life, etc. So victimization actually makes you stuck in yourself and you forget it. It dissociates you from powers greater than you, from meaning greater than you. You have meaningless life, as Shlomo felt it and many other people. And you see, when you speak in the office with someone, and you can feel sometimes the shallowness, the meaningless of life, a person is very shallow, and your stomach tells you there's a process of victimization here. This shallowness can be explained by the experience of being a victim, especially sexual abuse. And there is a wish for greater meaning in life. So this is the spiritual level. And many times people who suffered from victimization, if they go through what Mani described nicely as post-traumatic growth, they do tell us about some spiritual transformation out of this desperation of victimization. For example, there are very nice works of parents who lost their children, and well, there is a bereavement, of course, and it's endless. The pain is endless, but still, these parents found some hope and some, and what they call growth, what they call a spiritual transformation, spiritual meaning, and actually it helps them to feel their growth out of this victimization process. So we are talking about any kind of spiritual transformation that can be as part of the positive victimology perspective. Now, what is models of that I think that of practice that I think that represent pretty well positive victimology, this perspective. At first, if we speak about, and this is very where we are a bit different than positive psychology, because we are dealing with victimology, it's a different field. It's a special field, a substantive one, as the girl described this week. It means it has to do with psychology, sociology, it has to do with law, with social work, with biology, with economic, etc. If we look at the criminal justice system, I would look for, and she said it before, a victim-oriented criminal justice system. Well, it is not. It should be, but it is not. And even Paul Darby claimed it today. Sometimes it tries to, sometimes even not that. And what we proposed several years ago in a very nice and broad PhD study that Sarah and I supervised, the conclusion was that this is time for due process for victims. There is due process for offenders, which is very good. Johanna, I do agree, this is very good that there is a due process for offenders and should, or suspects, and it should be like this. But similarly, at least similarly, there should be a due process for victims. In the idea of the criminal justice system, there should be a due process for victims. We have to think about how do we treat them during this process. Do we keep their dignity, etc., etc.? There can be victim-oriented law enforcement procedures, like the idea of an appropriate restitution for victims. Can be a victim-empowering procedure or therapeutic jurisprudence process model that takes into account victims. It means that the therapeutic jurisprudence is not only for the offenders or suspects, but also for the victims should be therapeutic as well. Of course, restorative justice, it has all the levels of inclusion that I described, it has all the components. I think we heard enough about restorative justice, even though we can hear more and more, but I think this is one of the best examples of positive victimology in practice, in theory, in research, whatever. And of course, therapies for victims, like support groups for recovering victims, and individual therapy, etc., etc. Now, I think two good examples of positive victimology in practice are these two known ladies. The first one is Eva Moses-Kor. She is not only a Holocaust survivor, She was a twin, manganese twin. She was part of it. And if I remember rightly, if I wrote it, I think her sister was killed over there in Auschwitz by Mengele's experiments. She survived. She became the president of the organization of Mengele's twins, the survivors of Mengele twins. She was a bit in Israel, and then she moved to New York, and so she's part in Israel, part in New York. She considers herself more American than Israeli today. She's still with us, she's an old lady now. And several years ago, I don't remember how, there was kind of connection between her and a doctor, a physician who worked for Mengele. And she wrote to him. He was shocked by it. And then he took the challenge. He was not in prison or whatever. He got free after the war. Anyhow, he was shocked by her approaching him, and they met. And he told her that after the war, he couldn't sleep even one night, because it came back to him. It came back to him what he did. And when she approached him, actually, she freed him by this. And then in 1995, they both fought at Auschwitz, and they together, and she said that she forgave him. And there was a lot of noise around against her, but she said this has helped her also. 10 years later, 2005, she said publicly, and he was with her as well, that she forgave Mengele. Well, this is a task. I mean, she suffered something, but she overcame it. She said, now I can sleep at night. I couldn't sleep before. Now I can sleep at night. It's like she freed herself from a burden that was there for years by years by years, days by days, and she freed herself. So I felt as though an incredibly heavy weight of suffering had been lifted. I never thought I could be so strong. It is amazing. Laura Blumenfeld, she wrote a very interesting book called Revenge, A Story of Hope. I don't want to spoil you, so I will not tell you the end of this book. I recommend to read it. Laura was a Jewish young woman in New York. Her father was a reformist rabbi. It's just the opposite of the ultra-Orthodox Jews that Mali described. He went on a trip to Israel and he was shot by a terrorist, shot in his head. Fortunately for him, he was just injured, and after 3 days or 4 days, he was out of the hospital. She was a teenager in those days, and she said, well, you don't mess with the Blumenfeld. I'm gonna take revenge of this person who shot my father. And then she grew up, she became a non-journalist, and as in her 30s, I think, which was the late 90s or early 2000, whatever, she came to Israel to look for the shooter, this is the name she called him, and for revenge, to plan a revenge. And she did a study about revenge. She went all around the world to study what is revenge about. To Albania, to Sicily, to Iran even. She wore all these dresses, and she spoke there with a mufti or whatever, with a sheikh, and she shared what is revenge and the necessity of revenge. And then she contacted this family, and I let you read the end by yourself, what revenge she found. I just can tell you this is a story of hope, and this is not criminality, but positive victimology. No 5 minutes, I'm done. Thank you very much.